Hey. Time for convening having arrived. The Senate will come to order. Would ask unauthorized visitors to exit chamber and the Senate will come to order. Chair recognizes the Senator from the 53rd.
Here on the 31st legislative day, the journal has been read and found to be correct.
Thank you, Senator, for your good works on the journal. Is there objection to dispensing with the reading of the journal? Reading of the journal is dispensed with. Is there objection to the confirmation of the journal? Chairs none, and the journal is confirmed. All senators having bills and resolutions to introduce, please bring them to the Secretary's desk at this time. First reading in reference of Senate bills and resolutions.
Senate Bill 249 by Senator Beach of the 21st. A bill to be entitled.
Slogo.
Senate Resolution 499 by Senators Lucas of the 26th and others. A resolution creating the Senate Free Hunting and Fishing Licenses for Veterans Study Committee and for other purposes.
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 502 by Senators Jackson of the 2nd and others. A resolution recognizing the potential.
Natural Resources.
Senate Resolution 506 by Senators Ligon of the 3rd and others. A resolution requiring.
Natural Resources.
Through with the order, Mr. President.
First reading in reference of House bills and resolutions.
House Bill 78 by Representatives Willard of the 51st and others. A bill to be entitled an act to
amend. Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 132 by Representative Hawkins of the 27th.
Regulated industries.
House Bill 150 by Representative Bruce of the
60th. Special judiciary.
House Bill 184 by Representative Casas.
Higher education.
House Bill 189 by Representatives Buckner of the 177th.
Natural resources.
House Bill 197 by Representative Powell of the 177th.
Finance.
House Bill 203 by Representative Hamilton of the 24th and others.
Government oversight.
House Bill 211 by Representative Benton of the 31st and
Finance.
Others.
Finance.
House Bill 238 by Representative Maxwell of the 17th.
Retirement.
House Bill 240 by Representative Carson of the 46th.
Insurance and labor.
House Bill 318 by Representative Stevens of the 164th.
Finance.
House Bill 371 by Representatives Harbin of the 122nd and others.
Finance.
House Bill 372 by Representatives Coomer of the 14th
Higher
and others.
Higher education.
House Bill 382 by Representatives Powell of the 171st and
Judiciary.
Others.
Judiciary.
House Bill 399 by Representatives Knight of the 130th and others.
Finance.
House Bill 402 by Representative Stevens of the 164th.
Natural Resources.
House Bill 407 by Representatives Powell of the 32nd and others.
Public Safety.
House Bill 434 by Representatives Weldon of the 3rd
Judiciary.
And others.
Judiciary.
House Bill 452 by Representatives Martin of the 49th and others.
Appropriations.
House Bill 458 by Representatives
Insurance
Atwood.
Insurance and Labor.
House Bill 463 by Representatives Rice of the 95th.
Finance.
House Bill 473 by Representatives Welch of the 110th and others.
Slogo General.
House Bill 486 by Representative Roberts of the 155th and
Transportation.
Others.
Transportation.
House Bill 487 by Representatives Ramsey of the 72nd and
Regulated
others.
Regulated Industries.
House Bill 494 by Representatives Welch of the 110th
Transportation.
And others.
Transportation.
House Bill 497 by Representatives
Natural
Tanner.
Natural Resources.
House Bill 499 by Representative Sheldon of the 104th and others.
Judiciary.
House Bill 506 by Representative Smyrie of the 135th and others.
Judiciary.
House Bill 511 by Representative Dempsey.
Health and Human Services.
House Bill 512 by Representatives Jaspers of the 11th
Judiciary
and others.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 513 by Representative Houston of the 170th and others.
Health and Human Services.
House Bill 517 by Representative Williams of the 119th and others. A bill to be entitled.
Regulated Industries.
House Bill 536 by Representative Sims of the 169th and others. A bill.
Judiciary.
House Bill 537 by Representative Sims of the 169th and others.
Education and Youth.
House Bill 538 by Representative Sims of the 169th and others.
Health and Human Services.
House Bill 539 by Representative Sims of the 169th
Higher
and others.
Higher Education.
House Bill 540 by Representative Sims
Retirement.
Of the 169th. House Resolution 73 by Representatives Hugley of the.
Appropriations.
House Resolution 107 by Representative Sheldon
Rules.
Of the 107th. House Resolution 603 by Representative Dempsey of the 13th
Health
and others.
Health and Human Services.
Through with the order, Mr. President.
Clerk will read reports of standing committees.
Mr. President, the Senate State and Local Governmental Operations Committee has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation, that House Bill 508 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Ligon of the 3rd, Chairman. Through with the order, Mr. President.
Second readers. It's time for the morning roll call. Are there any motions to excuse? Chair recognized, Senator in the 44th.
Senator from the 43rd.
What number?
43rd.
Without objection.
Thank you.
Senator from the 43rd will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator of the 1st.
Mr. President, I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 27th.
27th, without objection, Senator will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator from 36th.
I move the unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 34th, who is in the Capitol on business.
34th, without objection, Senator will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator from 17th. 19th, without objection, Senator will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator from 49th.
Unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 9th and the Senator from the 54th for business outside the Capitol. Thank you, sir.
9th and 54th. Chair recognizes Senator from the 18th.
President, I ask unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 37th for business outside.
37th. Without objection, Senator will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator from the 50th. Are there any other motions to excuse? Chair recognizes Senator from 42nd.
Ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 41st.
41st, without objection, Senator will be excused. Are there any other motions to excuse? Senator 23rd.
Mr. President, I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the, he just arrived.
Very good. Any other motions? Senators, please signify your presence by voting the yea switch. Secretary will unlock the machine. It is now time for our morning devotion. Morning devotion would ask that senators please take your seats and cease conversation, and doorkeepers will go ahead and secure the chamber at this time. It's now my distinct honor to recognize the senator from the 44th for the purpose of leading us in our pledge and introducing our chaplain of the day. Senator.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now the Georgia flag.
Pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation.
Senators and guests, I am so delighted this morning to present our chaplain of the day. He is the Reverend Anthony J. McMichael. The Bible clearly states that too much is given, much is required. This quote is certainly relevant in the life and legacy of Atlanta's native son, Reverend Anthony J. McMichael, pastor of the Mount Nebo Baptist Church and Life Center and the Mount Nebo Cathedral South. Reverend McMichael received his undergraduate degree in theology in 1974 from Mercer University and received and earned a master's degree in divinity from Morehouse Seminary at the Interdenominational Theological Center here in Atlanta. As senior pastor of Mount Nebo, Reverend McMichael played a major role in establishing the church as a center of hope, reinforcing the fact that the church cannot live apart from the community. In addition to overseeing the church's numeric growth, he also was a major catalyst for the reconstruction of the community, which includes the $7 million campus of meetings for the home complex, which consists of an academy, a gymnasium, and health and fitness facility. The facility is also the frequent site for meetings, for home buyer education seminars, for credit counseling classes, for mentoring, for tutoring, and social rehabilitation. In essence, the Life Center takes a holistic approach at ministry families, where families within are given access to life-changing community outreach programs and services. Reverend McMichael is the recipient of countless preaching awards, including the Morehouse School of Religion Distinguished Alumni Award, the Atlanta Gospel Choice Award, the Reverend Charles Sargent Preaching Award, and the Mahala Jackson Evangelist of the Year Award. Reverend McMichael is married to Mrs. Brenda Love McMichael, a renowned educator, and the two have two adult children. I am so delighted to have him in my district. His reputation preceded him before he came. He has Mount Nebo Church on Moreland Avenue, and then came to Clayton County in Jonesboro, Ontario, with Mount Nebo South. We are so delighted to have him come today and give us a word from the Lord. Reverend McMichael.
Thank you, Senator Davenport, and to Lieutenant Cagle, Lieutenant Governor, and to the senators that are part of this legislation and that are part of this, that makes a part of the decisions that come out of this room that governs our community. And to all others who have gathered here today. It is Monday, and I see it on your faces. Know how you feel. I live in Douglas County, even though I do so much in Atlanta and Fulton and Clayton. And you know that drive in Douglas County is not one that you start out at the last minute. So I know the feeling. However, we're called to do a task. Today, let me just share this with you as we take an in-touch comment. And it says basically this. While it is often a struggle to put everything on the altar, everything on the Senate's floor, one thing I've learned is you don't have to understand how God will accomplish his plan. All he asks of you and us is that you surrender your will to his trust, and that he will show you the way. Abraham's willingness to give up what was most precious to him came from his unyielding faith in the Lord's trustworthiness. However, if you tell God, "No, I will not follow what you have instructed me to do, because you won't explain it to me, or I don't know the reason," he wants you to have faith. He wants you to do something according to the unseen. And when you refuse to obey what God has called you to do, then what happens is that you hinder your greatness. and all that you can become and accomplish in the lives of so many others and yourself. But when you say yes to him, yes, I will support the various problems of the world and resolving them. Yes, I will go and forsake my own needs for the needs of others. Then what happens is the windows of heaven opens and pours out greatness in you as leaders, as proclaimers, as builders. As much as we depend so much on that which is earthen and people, we should never negate the voice of God, which projects righteousness, justice, that which is good and that which is fair, and above all, that which is merciful. Don't mistake his ways of all of this, because there is a reward as a result. Obeying God positions us to receive further strength, further power, further love, to change a world gone bad into a world that knows nothing but good. Question: what has God told you? Have you only partially cooperated? Have you only partially given of the best for humankind that all might benefit in such a way that we will establish the equality of mankind and proclaim that all men and women are created equal? That is the responsibility that you and I have as representatives of communities, churches, counties, states. We have become the steward. And so when you even make the statement that I represent my district, it's not really your district, because all things belong to God. However, you have become the steward of it. What do you do to the district to increase the greatness of this enlarged community? May we stand and pray. Oh God, as this session opens, we ask that you would move in a profound way, so profound that we will relinquish ourselves to yield to hear what you have designed for this world to become. Decisions made. Those who are that in need, those that are impoverished. For this is the season that you have appointed us to release the captives, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. Now, God, we ask that you give covering over this golden dome in such a way that as people walk in, decisions are made, the whole state will feel not only a physical difference for the better, but a spiritual. Give covering over the governor. Give covering over this lieutenant governor, the senator, Gil Davenport, every senator that sits in this room. Guide our steps. In other words, as you make the steps, may we not vacillate those steps, but remember that you set the path and we step accordingly to where you have left the footprints for the life of the world. An awesome task, but we accept it because of your will. We are here. Thank you for allowing us to be stewards. Carry us for the rest of our term to know that we are here to represent the greater good. We love you. We honor you. We open this section because you are God. For it is in thy name we pray. Blessings to all. Amen.
By Representative Delvick of the 40th, the bill to amend an act creating a new charter for the city of members under certain circumstances. HB 551 by resolution night of the 130th, a bill to amend an act to create a new charter for the city of Locust Grove. HB 552 by resolution Morris of the 156th, a bill to create a board of education elections at Appling County. HB 553 by resolution Morris of the 156th, a bill to amend an act repealing an act creating board of commissioners of roads and revenues in Montgomery County, creating a new board of commissioners. HB 554 by resolution Weldon of the 3rd, a bill relating to commercial code. HB 556 by Representative Smyre of the 135th, a bill to authorize the Recorder's Court of Columbus, Georgia to impose a collected technology fee for each fine imposed. HR 604 by Representative Gardner of the 57th, the resolution honoring the life of Senior Patrol Officer Gail Denise Thomas, dedicating an interchange in her memory. Senate Bill 1 by Senator Ligon of Jr. of the 3rd, bill relating to respectively to insurance domestic relations. Senate Bill 99 by Senator Hill of the 32nd, a bill relating to county special purpose local option sales tax. Senate Bill 116 by Senator Thompson of the 5th, a bill relating to homicide by vehicle. Senate Bill 145 by Senator Heath of the 31st, a bill relating to bona fide conservation use property. Senate Bill 155 by Senator Goodger of the 51st, a bill relating to scholarships, loans, and grants. Senate Bill 163 by Senator Legge Jr. of the 3rd, a bill relating to medical assistance. Senate Bill 181 by Senator Bethel of the 54th, a bill relating to American History Month and Georgia History Month. Senate Bill 185 by Senator Stone of the 23rd, a bill relating to secure transactions. Senate Bill 204 by Senator Couser of the 46th, a bill relating to judgments and rulings deemed directly appealable. Senate Bill 207 by Senator Alberts of the 56th, a bill relating to probation for first offenders. Senate Bill 212 by Senator Mollis of the 53rd, a bill relating to competencies and core curriculum. Senate Bill 216 by Senator Carter of the 1st, a bill relating to pharmacies. Senate Bill 224 by Senator Golden of the 8th, a bill relating to the Seed Capital Fund. Senate Resolution 378 by Senator Mollis of the 53rd, resolution proposing an amendment to the Constitution so as to provide that the General Assembly may provide by law for the dedication of revenues collected from the state sale of fireworks for the funding of trauma care and firefighter services in the state of Georgia. Through second readers.
Reports of standing committees, the clerk will read.
Representative Sims, 169, Chairman of Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination has consideration of the following bills of the House and bill of the Senate. Struck me report the same back to the House following recommendation. House Bill 522, 525, 529, 534, 543, 544, due pass. Senate Bill 199, due pass. Respect submitted. Representative Sims, Chair, through the committee reports.
All right, we're about to go on to the local calendar. The House is about to take up some business that will require the attention of the members that are on the floor. All right, we're going on to the local calendar for today. There is one bill on today's local calendar that relates to homestead exemption and requires a recorded two-thirds roll call vote for passage. If there is no objection, we will vote on the local calendar as a whole with a recorded vote. Hearing none, it is so ordered. The clerk will read the local calendar.
House Bill 522 by Representative Rutledge, 109, Henry County. House Bill 525 by Representative Tankersley, 160th, Bullock County. House Bill 529 by Representative Hardin, 148th, Crisp County. House Bill 543 by Representative Gradley of 67th, Douglas County. House Bill 544 by Representative Turner, 21st, Cherokee County. Senate Bill 199 by Senator Stone, 23rd, McDuffie County. House Bill 534 by Representative Houston, 170th, Tift County, above local. Foregoing local bills haven't been for the House Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination. Committee recommends that these local bills do pass. Bills being read today for the third time.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered on the local calendar? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bills. The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to.
Like to have the Senate's attention for just a moment and recognize the distinguished senator from the 35th to recognize a special guest.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senators, this is Women's Month in the United States of America. And on this past weekend, the state of Georgia was honored to have International Women's Day, and they celebrated it with all the chambers of commerce from around the world, right in downtown Atlanta, across from the Marriott. And one of our very special women who could have been the International Woman of the Year is with us this morning, and I can't hear myself. I cannot hear myself.
Yeah, keep going.
Wow. Thank you. And it was Helen Reddy that said, I am woman, hear me roar. It was a great poet, Maya Angelou, who has a poem called Phenomenal Woman, Phenomenally Phenomenal. And either one of them must have had this wonderful woman in mind when they wrote those words. We have with us the Honorable Akua Sina Dasua, and she is a three-term member of Parliament from January 7, 2001 to January 6, 2012, and she's been the Minister for Tourism from February 2011 until January 2013, and she is up for another outstanding office in her country in Ghana. She was formerly Minister of Youth and Sports and the first woman to occupy this position in Ghana. During her tenure, the Honorable Dasua led the Ghanaian contingent to 2010 FIFA South Africa World Cup tournament and the national team, the Black Stars, being the only African team to reach the quarterfinal stage. Prior to this, she had held the position of Minister of Women and Children's Affairs and also occupied the position of Deputy Whip within the leadership of Parliament of Ghana from 2004 until 2011. The Honorable Dasua initially trained as a journalist with a distinction diplomat in journalism in 1982. She has traveled the world. She has been to Georgia before, and she practiced journalism for several years in Nigeria and Ghana and participated in numerous international conferences with the United Nations. At the peak of her career in 91, she won the Covenant Dag Hammarskjöld Fellowship as the most promising journalist in Africa in a keenly contested competition organized by the United Nations Correspondents Association, and she won. See, she is awesome. This woman is amazing. The Honorable Dasua is a local advisor for the African Women Development Fund, which is headquartered in Ghana, and she is over the gender and children rights and HIV and AIDS. She's an activist for the people with great interest in NGO work and has expertise in communications, gender and youth development, local and international governance, sports for development, and sustainable tourism. She has been serving as the tourism minister. So without further ado, let me tell you, not only did she win a distinguished award this weekend, but this body is about to give her an honorary Georgia Citizen Award. So Honorable Dasua, mother of three lovely children and outstanding woman of the year, please come forward.
I am so honored to present to you from the Secretary of State, Brian P. Kemp, the Honorable Akua Sena Dasua, as an honorary Georgia citizen, and may this honorary citizen be afforded every courtesy as a goodwill ambassador from Georgia in her travels to other states, to nations beyond the borders, and the United States of America, or wherever she may hereafter travel or reside. It's my honor for me and the Lieutenant Governor to present this award to you.
Thank you very much, Senator Donzella James, for this great honor. Lieutenant Governor Cassie Cagle, greetings to distinguished senators. As you have heard, I'm Honorable Akua Sena Dasua from Ghana. I bring you warm greetings from the motherland and also from our dynamic and hardworking president, His Excellency John Dramani Mahama. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the invitation to visit your beautiful state of Georgia, Atlanta. I want to use this opportunity to also thank Senator Donzella James for the leadership role you played in getting this visit come on. I am here on a goodwill mission from Ghana, West Africa, and I thank the Governor General for giving me the opportunity to address this house. I also want to thank you once again, Governor General and Senator Donzella James, for leading the charge to pass Senate Resolution 9, a resolution urging the Department of Economic Development to promote and strengthen mutually beneficial ties with Africa and for other purposes. And I must say that I'm very glad to be the first African diplomat to be here since the resolution was passed. And I want to assure you that I'm going back home to work with my president and the leadership of Ghana to strengthen this partnership and collaboration that you intend to have between you and Africa, and particularly my country. I want to tell you that there are many opportunities in Ghana. Ghana is a leader in democracy and good governance in Africa. We have a very strong regulatory framework to protect investments in Ghana. We have a warm climate and a warm people, and we are prepared to protect any investment or any partnership that you have in Ghana. And before I end, Lieutenant Governor, I want to thank you once again, the whole Senate, Senator Donzella James, the Ghana Council, the Ghana World Council of Commerce, Mr. and Mrs. Pamford of strictlybusinesslimousine.com here in Atlanta, Georgia, and any other person who played a role in making my visit very, very successful. Once again, I thank you for the great honor done me, and I want to assure you that I'll be a very distinguished ambassador of the state of Atlanta, Georgia. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
I'd like to present the Doctor of the Day, and to do so, I call upon the distinguished senator from the 27th.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's indeed an honor for me to introduce the Doctor of the Day. Matthew Watson is board certified by the American Board of Emergency Medical doctor. Dr. Watson received his undergraduate degree from Moravian College and earned his medical degree from Jefferson Medical College. He completed his emergency medical residency at Geisinger Medical Center in Danville, PA. Dr. Watson is a partner with Northside Emergency Associates and cares for ER patients at Northside Hospital at Forsyth County. Dr. Watson maintains a membership locally and is the state and medical societies, including the Medical Association of Georgia and the American Medical Association. He is currently the president of Georgia College of Emergency Physicians and serves on the National American College of Emergency Physicians Steering Committee. Dr. Watson and his wife, Chris, raising three children in Forsyth County. During his spare time, he enjoys coaching, Little League, and skiing. Let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Watson personally. He, at Northside Hospital in the past few years, he's attended my late wife, Wendy. He's attended my dad. He's attended my mother, and he's also attended me in the emergency room in Northside Forsyth. And in addition to that, he's very involved in the politics of what's going on and the legislation that we pass down here. And I can guarantee you from time to time, he doesn't mind texting me and talking with me and expressing his opinion about what's going on legislatively. So he's very involved. He's the kind of doctor that we want out there and the kind that's looking over our shoulder and making sure that we're doing what we're supposed to. So let's give a big welcome to Dr. Matthew Watson.
I just want to thank you all for inviting me in. I'm glad that I could provide the services today for the members here and anybody else that needs to stop by. It's already been quite a busy morning. I know the pollen counts are up and people are getting the house bug that's been going around. So if anybody needs to stop over into the medical clinic, we'll be over there. I want to thank Jack for the kind words that he gave me. It's been a pleasure to treat him and his family. If there's anything that the Georgia College of Emergency Physicians or the Medical Association of Georgia can do to help render opinions or give you the physician opinion for things that you guys are considering, please don't hesitate to contact me or anybody else in the societies. We'll be glad to help out however we can. But thank you and keep up the good work.
Good to see you. Appreciate that. Good. Are there any unanimous consents? Any senator wish to rise on a point of personal privilege? Chair recognizes Senator 20th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today I come down here to just talk to you about one of our Senate family members, probably one of the most awesome ladies I have had the privilege of getting to know over the last decade, and Angie Feast, who works Senate research and has worked for our committee since 2005. Angie went to Georgia Tech, and I don't hold that against her. And then she got her law degree from Georgia State University. She is an awesome policy person that really does a lot of work for our committee. Angie and her husband, DJ, they have a three-year-old daughter. And this past autumn, they were blessed to find news that their family was growing. But they were surprised to hear that they had four little ones coming. One set of identical twins that were two boys and a fraternal set of twins, a boy and a girl. Obviously, this is a high-risk pregnancy. Angie is such a little bitty girl and runs marathons and all. And anyway, about a week, Sunday night a week ago, DJ had to rush Angie to the hospital because her water broken and she was only at about 20 weeks in her pregnancy. They lost one of the babies that evening, and that was born and subsequently passed away the next morning. Angie's going to be in the hospital for a while. She is a she's doing pretty good, but we need to keep her in our prayers. She is one of the most awesome people that I have ever had the opportunity to know, and we really want to keep her in our prayers. They've got a long ways to go. They have three children left coming, and we need to really pray for them because they've got the children weren't supposed to be born until July. And so if y'all will, when you have those moments and at night when you go to bed, say a little prayer for Angie and DJ that they can get through this very tough time and can get through this, and these three children that are left will be born healthy. Okay. If you would join me in a moment of silence for Angie, DJ, and the three children that are left struggling to fight for their survival.
Let's pray.
Thank you very much.
Amen. Thank you, Senator.
Chair recognizes Senator of the 54th for a point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, I'll be brief, but it is important that we remember our past. And I wanted to bring you to the Senate's attention, if you were not already aware, that yesterday marked the 100th anniversary of the death of Harriet Tubman. And obviously, Ms. Tubman was someone born a slave in this country, escaped for her own freedom, and on several occasions risked her own life, returning into the South after the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. She started transporting folks across both southern and northern borders into Canada, and just wanted to recognize that that is a true American life, pursuing the principle of freedom that we all enjoy, and just didn't want that day to go missed in our Senate. Thank you, Mr. President.
We have a consent calendar of privilege resolutions that are before you. Is there objection? Without objection, the consent calendar of privilege resolutions are therefore adopted. Are there any motions to withdraw or commit? Mr. Secretary, are there any objections filed on any of the bills on the local consent calendar?
Mr. President, there are no objections filed in the Secretary's office.
Is there objection agreeing to report a committee on state and local governmental operations which fair will pass the bill? Chair hears none. Report of committee is agreed to. Questions on the passage of the local consent calendar. All of those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Local consent calendar. On the local consent calendar, the yeas are 49 and the nays are 0. And this bill haven't received these bills haven't received requisite constitutional majority. They are therefore adopted. Secretary will read House Bill 101.
House Bill 101 by Representative Epps, the 144th, and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 26-2-370 of the OCGA relating to definitions relative to food service establishments so as to exclude certain events held by nonprofit organizations from the definition of food service establishment and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Agriculture recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. The Agriculture and Consumer Affairs Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 101. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 26-2-370 of the OCGA relating to definitions relative to food service establishments and for other purposes. Through with the order, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes the distinguished agriculture chairman, Senator from the 50th.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, House Bill 101 deals with food service establishment exemptions and permits. Currently, there are three tiers of food regulation: restaurants, temporary food service for for-profit events lasting up to 14 days, and nonprofit events as part of a fair or festival for events that last 5 days or less. What this bill does is strike the words fair or festival and instead replace simply with the word event. At the current time, activities such as Relay for Life or Sheriff's Barbecue and those kind of events are not categorized as fairs or festivals, so they're having to meet the requirements for the upper tier, the temporary food service, and those requirements are more stringent, and it makes it difficult for them to meet those requirements. So this bill would simply change fair or festival to event, and then the amendment would state that the person holding the event would have to have written permission from the person who owns the property to hold the event. Mr. President, if there are no questions, I'll yield the well.
No questions, Senator. Question on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection? Chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection agreed to port of committee which failed pass the bill? Chair is none. Port of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none, and the main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 50 and the nays are 0, and this bill, MC Rex Constitution Majority, is therefore adopted. Secretary will read House Bill 198.
House Bill 198 by Representative Smith of the 134th and others, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Title 33 of the OCGA relating to insurance so as to provide for licensing of health insurance navigators under the Federal Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Insurance and Labor recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. The Senate Committee on Insurance and Labor offers the following substitute to House Bill 198, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Title 33 of the OCGA relating to insurance so as to provide for licensing of health insurance navigators under the Federal Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act and for other purposes. Amendment 1. Senator Davis of the 22nd and others offer the following amendment. Amend the committee substitute to House Bill 198 by deleting lines 43 through 47 and redesignating paragraphs 2 through 5 on lines 48 through 61 as paragraphs 1 through 4, respectively. Through with the order, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 8th, Distinguished Insurance Committee Chairman. Please give the Senator your attention.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise in support of House Bill 198. This bill came from the Chairman of the House Insurance Committee. Very simply, the bill deals with the Affordable Care Act in relation to the navigators. Navigators are going to be the ones who steer people in the direction of health insurance needs. This is a consumer protection bill that allows the commissioner to commission to approve to make sure that any navigator that's given out information on health insurance is qualified. As you know, the exchanges, like it or not, are coming, and under federal law, all this bill does, very simply, is make sure by giving the authority to the Commissioner of Insurance, there are about five different things that allow him to go through and make sure that they are indeed qualified to give out this advice. We did a committee substitute that came to me at the request of consumer groups representing the elderly, the senior population, children, and others, make sure that they were also knowledgeable about Medicaid and Peach Care, and that is another qualification we added to the insurance commissioner to have that authority. With that, Mr. President, I yield for any questions and ask for your support. If not, there are no questions.
Chair,
and the amendment. Mr. Chairman, Mr. President, if I can go ahead and address the amendment.
Yes, you can.
There is an amendment. I'm sorry that I'm going to oppose that amendment. I understand why, but basically all that amendment does is take away the authority of the insurance commissioner, and I think that would be a mistake. That's the whole point of this bill, is empowering the commissioner of insurance to make the call whether or not they're qualified. He does that right now across the board in all his licenses. He has a right to reject a license, pull a license of anybody, whether you're selling auto insurance, health insurance, or whatever product you're selling related to insurance, and I think that'd be a mistake to take that out of the bill. So I will oppose Amendment 1. I understand the Senator from the 22nd can speak to it. We had a discussion. I appreciate very much him making me aware of his amendment. It was very kind of him.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th for a question. 34.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
Certainly.
Senator, these navigators, isn't this a part, or is it a part of the Obamacare?
It is a part of the Affordable Care Act, yes.
But that is affectionately known as the Obamacare. I mean, and he does care. He told me that personally, so it's okay. But if the senator will yield.
Yes.
I haven't kept up, and I apologize. It was a busy weekend.
Sure.
Has the governor accepted the expansion?
This has nothing to do whether you are for or against the exchanges. The governor's position is he was opposed to the state creating those exchanges. The federal government will create the exchange, and it is a federal law that will apply to all 50 states.
Senator,
so
will
this
you
has
deal?
Nothing to do with the exchange, whether you're for or against it. It's just saying if you're going to have the exchange, we want those offering that advice on health insurance to be qualified.
Thank you. Senator, will you yield?
Sure.
Senator, these navigators, are they paid navigators?
I'm not sure whether they're paid or not, to be quite frank. But you're going to have navigators under the federal act, and we want to make sure they're qualified.
That was the reasoning for my question, because I was wondering if we're taking pieces of the Obamacare to help fund the navigators. We're not?
No. There are 18 states that have passed legislation similar to this. You're going to see other states doing it. They're wanting to make sure navigators are qualified.
Will the senator further yield?
Sure.
You just said the navigators are qualified, and you're saying the insurance commissioner is the one who qualifies them?
Yes. I did not say they were qualified. I'm saying the point of this legislation is to ensure that they are qualified.
And that assurance, if you further yield, is coming from the insurance commissioner's office?
The commissioner of insurance right now is in charge of the entire insurance industry. So whether you sell auto insurance, whether you sell property and casualty, whatever product you sell, health insurance, whatever product, he right now is the one in charge of making sure that they are qualified, that they are licensed. And under this bill, you don't have to be licensed, you have to be qualified.
Thank
you, Senator. He makes that determination, so why wouldn't it be him to make it on this?
Senator, and thank you for that clarification, because
sure.
I'm still getting confused. I'm trying to understand. This legislation is necessary because we are taking a part of the Obamacare and we are creating navigators, which is a part of that act. And under the Obamacare, we are now saying we're going to have navigators, but we don't know if they're going to be paid, nor if they are paid, where's the funding coming from?
Under federal law, the navigators are part of the act. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The navigators are a part of the Obamacare, if you wish to call it that. So that's all I'm saying. It has nothing to do with other than making sure they're qualified. They're under the federal act. We're under federal law. That's all this bill does. I don't know if I can be any clearer than that.
Okay, one final question, and maybe I'll get clear as we move forward with some of the other. So it's my understanding that we as a state, with the governor leading, is not accepting Obamacare, but we are accepting a part of that act with the navigator part that gives the commissioner the authority to make sure that all of the navigators, paid or not and from where or not, is trained by him or is qualified by him.
I suspect they're paid under federal law, but I'm not a part of the federal government. So let me be clear again. You have federal law under the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare. The federal law says we will have exchanges. All we're saying, if you're going to have exchanges, we're doing what other states are doing is making sure that those offering that advice are qualified. That's all we're doing.
Thank you, Senator. I'll further listen, and hopefully I'll get a little bit clearer answers. Thank you.
I don't know if I can be any clearer.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th for a question. 39th.
Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
I, too, have some clarifying questions, and I appreciate this opportunity to ask them.
Sure.
So, first of all, the Affordable Health Care Act, Obamacare, requires these navigators. Is that not true?
That's correct.
Okay. So, this is the first step toward the health care exchanges, correct? This is something that's being put in place in order to prepare.
Under the federal act, you will have the states had the option of taking that and doing it as a state, or you could decline and the feds would take over. And of course, the governor has declined. The federal government is bringing exchanges supposedly in October. I'll be surprised if they're here in October. I'm not sure how they're going to get here in October, but if they are, all we're doing under this bill is saying the navigators under this federal act will be qualified. We will be the 19th state to do so.
As part of Obamacare.
Correct.
Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
Now, on this issue of compensation, is it not true that states will get grants from the federal government as a part of the Affordable Health Care Act to states in order to provide to entities who will be navigators?
Maybe I misspoke on another. I assume that anybody giving out this advice is not going to be doing it for free, and the federal government will be picking up the cost of those navigators, if that would answer the question more clearly. I'm sorry if I wasn't clear on that. I apologize. That's pretty I was making an assumption. I apologize for that.
Right. Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
So therefore, the feds provide grants to states to provide money grants to local entities to train navigators as based on the rules passed by the insurance commissioner if the amendment does not pass. Is that correct?
I assume the senator's correct in that assumption.
All right. And one final question.
Sure.
And I just want to be clear on this. This is the first step toward creating exchanges. In our instance, well, there's going to be a federal exchange in Georgia unless something changes, and that this providing for navigators will be giving advice to the public on what that healthcare exchange will provide. Is that correct? The plans?
Correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
All right. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from 38 for a question.
Will the senator yield?
Yes.
According to the information that I have, it says that the Secretary of Health and Human Services is to establish the standards by which the states will go about ensuring that the navigators are qualified. Have we received those standards from Health and Human Services Secretary?
Senator, I have no idea. I would not know the answer to that.
So if you will further yield, are we not
yes.
putting the cart before the horse if we haven't gotten the actual standards that they're trying to implement in this bill?
Again, Senator, I think this is a consumer protection bill. You know, it passed the House almost, you know, it was overwhelming. I think the vote was 154-16. I suspect it had been unanimous if we'd had the committee substitute that put in there about Medicaid and Peach Care. I would assume it'd be unanimous because the groups that came to me were advocates, and they were in favor of consumer protection. That's what this bill does. Other states are taking this same approach to make sure, again, I don't know what else I can say about it other than we're trying to make sure that those offering this advice are qualified.
Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
If the standards have not been established by Health and Human Services, are we not putting the cart before the horse, even though it is consumer protections? We don't know what is going to come down as our standards. Is that not
Senator, clear? The thought right now, and I said this already, is it would be the exchanges are supposed to be in place in October. We're meeting now. If we're going to do this, we have to do it now to affect it in October. Whether or not they'll be up and running in October, I have no idea. There's a lot of work to be done. There are a lot of regs, I guess, to be coming down. All this bill does, and this is all it does, is said those navigators will be qualified to give this advice. It's that simple.
Will the senator further the year?
Yes.
Once again, my question to you is, according to Section 1312 of the Act, the Secretary will establish procedures under which states may allow agents or brokers to enroll. We are establishing that without knowing what the Secretary is saying the standards are supposed to be. Is that not true?
We know if the exchanges are coming, there will be navigators that will be steering individuals into the various health care, either the Medicaid, Peach Care, or into insurance plans. And so all this bill does is say those people giving that advice will be qualified. It has nothing to do with any regs that may be coming in other areas. We do know navigators will exist. We know that under the federal law that's already passed.
Well, the senator further yield. I'm
yes.
going to say this again. Is it not true that we are supposed to get the standards from Health and Human Services by which we make determination as to what these navigators are supposed to be doing?
Well, I just said that there'll be additional regs coming down. All this bill says, it doesn't say you won't be dealing with those regulations when they come. Navigators will be qualified and will be approved by the insurance commissioner. I don't know what more I can say.
Based
I understand if you're wanting me to say the regs or other regs are still coming, yes.
No, Senator, that's not what I want you to say. I'm simply saying that it says that we should be getting that direction. The standard should be coming down from HHS, and then we do this after we receive direction as to that particular situation. I'm just saying we're putting the cart before the horse. Is that not true?
Well, that's your opinion, and you certainly, Senator, have the right to your opinion. So.
Thank you, Senator.
And I respect that right. Thank you for the questions.
Chair recognizes Senator from 36 for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator yield.
Yes.
If you would, I'll try to not duplicate questions that have already been asked, but this is worth, I think, taking a close look at so that we fully understand it. I have a concern in some low-income neighborhoods that many of us represent. They're nonprofit agencies that can help steer and guide the clients that they serve so that they get through the right portal on the exchange. And in fact, some people accessing the exchange would wind up being eligible for Medicaid and would go through that portal. My concern is that we don't, with this, by taking this action, would we be blocking those nonprofits from working with their clients or from actually being qualified as navigators? Because a navigator can be a whole organization, as I understand it.
No, we would not, Senator. You know, I met with those groups, and that's one reason we did a committee substitute. We wanted to make them, they came to me wanting to be more comfortable with the bill, and I agreed with them. And that's the whole reason we made the substitute, was to make sure Medicaid and children and the seniors, have their input into that the navigators were qualified to make recommendations for those groups, put it that way.
Well, I appreciate, isn't it true, that you took the time and had the time to get that input and make adjustments. Is it possible as a result of this language that we're authorizing the commissioner to bar people that aren't licensed as insurance brokers or agents?
My understanding is if you look at the legislation, it gives the commissioner the right to make sure they're qualified. They don't necessarily have to be licensed. I suspect most of them will be licensed people, just because if you look at the qualifications, but it doesn't mean you have to be. You have to have 35 hours of coursework in the health insurance field, and then there are a list of other qualifications. And as I said earlier, the commissioner has that right now to pull anybody's license if he deems that fit, that they're unfit to, or whatever reason he wants to cite, he can pull their license now. So all we're doing is saying to the commissioner, somebody has to be in charge of making sure they're qualified, and stands to reason me, it'd be the commissioner of insurance.
So if you'll further yield, you feel comfortable that we're not, by taking this action, going down a path to require navigators to be insurance brokers or agents?
That would be my understanding of it, Senator.
Thank you.
Mr. President, no other questions. I yield the well. I ask that you don't take Amendment 1 from the Senator 22nd, because I believe the Commissioner of Insurance has the right now to control who has a license, who doesn't have a license. Also, under this bill, while he would not be dealing with licenses, he would be dealing with whether they're not qualified or not. And the fact of the matter is, if he wants to pull a license now, it's because he would deem they're not qualified, or they've done something illegal, or there'd be some reason, some substantive reason, he'd have to yank that license. And under this, it just stands to reason he'd be the one to make sure that navigators are qualified. I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Senator from 22nd to speak to his amendment. Amendment number 1, please give the Senator your attention.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. I appreciate the Senator from the 8th bringing this measure before, so I think it's worthy of debate. And I'd like to draw your attention, if I could have the Senate's attention, I'd like to draw it to lines 43 through 47 on page 2 of the bill. It's a simple amendment, but one that I think is appropriate, because even as the Senator from the 8th has acknowledged, it is important for the Commissioner of Insurance, a former member of this esteemed body, to have the authority to regulate insurance in this state. I couldn't agree more. But at the same time, in an age of where we are concerned in this body, as well as in the House, and quite frankly, all across the state of Georgia, where we're concerned about transparency in government and making sure that we're upholding and protecting the interest and the trust of the public, these are the reasons why I think it's important to have an amendment like the one that we're offering here. Again, to my fellow senators, in lines 43 through 47, this language is extremely subjective. I'm all for giving the Commissioner of Insurance the authority to regulate insurance, or for that matter, healthcare exchanges that may or may not be established in the state of Georgia. But the concern that I have is the fact that we're indicating here that the applicant shall establish to the commissioner's satisfaction. I'm not sure how we measure or monitor the satisfaction of the commissioner as it relates to this, but what I am telling you is it lends itself to mischief and cronyism, and I don't think that we need that in the state of Georgia. At a time where it's vitally important for us to uphold the public trust, to suggest that we can create a healthcare exchange, and in this instance, as the senator from the 8th has indicated, all this bill does is provide for the establishment of healthcare navigators. I couldn't agree with him more. Healthcare navigators. Let's talk about that for a moment. The federal law, the Affordable Care Act, provides for establishing healthcare navigators in all of the states that do, in fact, enact healthcare exchanges. Georgia has made a decision, as we all are well aware of, that Georgia will not, in fact, enact the healthcare exchange. Interestingly enough, of the states that have made a decision, there are only 11 states that have actually made a decision to enact state-based healthcare exchanges. 25 states have declined, and then those other states have said, we want the federal government to come in and tell us how to do it. I find that extremely interesting here in Georgia. I find that interesting in most states that are red states, and that when we argue states' rights and free market capitalism, we cannot be duplicitous. I'm all for the free market. I'm all for letting the market forces take over and do what they're supposed to do. But in doing that, we have a responsibility to uphold the public trust. And so with Amendment 1, Mr. President, members of the Senate, all I'm asking for is for the senator from the 8th and those colleagues of mine in this great body to give strong consideration to supporting this amendment and simply striking lines 43 through 47 that do nothing to impair or impugn the bill, but in my mind, do everything to strengthen the bill that provide for the public trust and promote the public trust at a time where Georgians are desperately seeking that, wanting to know that they can look for their elected officials to do what's right because it's right and then do it right. And so, Mr. President, if there are no questions, I'll yield the will.
You do have some questions. Chair recognizes Senator on the 54th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the senator yield?
I will.
Senators, I understand your argument. Am I correct that your argument is that we simply should not allow the discretion to the commissioner in terms of who it is that's approved as a navigator in Georgia?
That's not what I'm saying to the senator from the 54th. What I'm saying is that the commissioner inherently has the authority to make that determination. We've created that opportunity for the commissioner to do that. He currently regulates all insurance in the state of Georgia. This bill does nothing to take that away in the sense that he currently has the authority to do that. What this measure does, and what I'm concerned about, is in a subjective fashion, we're now authorizing the commissioner in a very subjective fashion, as opposed to looking at the criteria that's established in lines 48 through 61, and we're saying at the discretion of the commissioner, if he likes Charlie Bethel, the senator from the 54th, better than he likes the senator from the 25th, he can then say, well, you know what? I think the senator from the 54th, he should have this ability to be a navigator, but the senator from the 25th, he shouldn't have that authority. And I categorically disagree with that.
Will the senator further yield?
I will.
Senator, the last word on line 59 is and, which I take to mean that that is a cumulative list, so that even if the commissioner did like me, wouldn't you agree that he couldn't award me unless I otherwise satisfied the list of items in paragraphs 2 through 5?
Could you repeat that?
The last word on line 59 is and, which means that the paragraphs 1 through 5 is a cumulative list. So even if the commissioner did like the senator from the 54th, he couldn't, based on paragraph 1, award me or anyone else navigator status unless I otherwise satisfied all the criteria of paragraphs 2 through 5. Is that correct?
I believe the senator knows of that which he speaks.
Will the senator further yield?
I will.
Senator, could you distinguish the language in lines 43 through 47 from lines 53 through 55 in terms of what you find objectionable? In other words, as I read 53 through 55, the commissioner develops whatever examination it is that he chooses. That is to say, as the shall be required by the commissioner is what the wording is on line 53. And my question to you is, is that less arbitrary than the language you oppose in lines 43 through 47?
Lines 43 through 47 to the senator from the 5th and 4th, in my mind, are not only arbitrary, nebulous, and quite subjective, to be quite frank with you. If you look at line 43, again, the applicant shall establish to the satisfaction. I don't know how to measure that. Whether I put an and gate on it or not, I don't know how to measure that. To the satisfaction of the commissioner, that he or she has the background, experience, knowledge, and competency. It almost sounds like a job application, that I went to Georgia Tech and you went to Georgia, and we're going to make a decision on the basis of that, as opposed to credentials. I don't think we want to do that to the senator from the 54th. I might also offer that should give all of us pause in the context of where we are from a legislative perspective. Again, in the spirit of this measure, I think it's a good bill. I not only think it's a good bill in that what we're trying to accomplish, but I might also offer that, as they have suggested, the author of the legislation has suggested, we've modeled it off of federal legislation. If that were true, the federal law says that it is not a requirement to be licensed in order to be a navigator. That's what the federal law says. But now we're going to come and say, I want you to be licensed so that I can draw a distinction between brokers and agents, between producers and brokers, as opposed to what the federal law says, that's not a requirement.
Thank you. Will the senator yield for a final question?
I will.
First, let me interject that I hope that you and I are never competing for the same employment. But I do want to ask, I guess the final question is, at times in this chamber, we have disagreements about what language it means. And would you at least agree that there is at least a scholarly dispute about whether or not the satisfaction of the commissioner has any substantive difference between the commissioner being able to establish a test? That is to say, it's a test, right? I mean, paragraphs 1 and paragraphs 3 could both be interpreted as a test at the discretion of the commissioner to establish the person is competent in the ways described in the bill.
Senator, I fundamentally disagree as it relates to paragraph 1 on the basis of the fact that it's extremely subjective. I believe the senator from the 5th and 4th would agree with me that in paragraphs 2 through 5, as you've so eloquently pointed out, they do establish a test. But in paragraph 1, it establishes something that's arbitrary, something that's discretionary, something that is extremely subjective, simply on the basis of a person's position.
Thanks, Senator. Thank you, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes Senator 33rd for a question.
The Senator yield.
I do.
Senator, while I'm not speaking of our current insurance commissioner, who is one of our colleagues, I believe he's a good man, but isn't it true that these folks are going to be paid by some means, by somebody?
That is true.
Right. Isn't it true then that there will be a large pot of money which tends to draw people to make these applications for these types of jobs or these types of decision makers?
I believe the senator knows of that which he speaks. And Senator, let me also add that it is extremely important to the senator from the 54th point of why there needs to be some level of tests applied as opposed to arbitration, discretion, and pure subjection, because the law currently states that these lists of groups and or peoples can in fact become navigators. Community-based organizations, ranching and farming organizations, chambers of commerce, unions, that word that we're going to hear more about later, Small Business Administration resource partners, licensed insurance agents and brokers, commercial fishing organizations, nonprofits, they could become navigators.
Will you further yield, Senator? Would you further yield?
I will.
Isn't it true from what I've been told and read here that there are certain qualifications or things that these people will have to follow that aren't really within our framework of knowledge due to the fact the federal government has not passed them down yet? Is that correct?
I believe the gentleman knows of that which he speaks.
So, Senator, will you further yield?
I will.
Is one of our points, or one of your points, that we're getting the cart before the horse and writing a law when we don't know what the full, we don't know what the federal laws will have to follow?
Well, I'm extremely concerned about that, Senator. Again, in fact, as we've made a decision in Georgia not to move forward with establishing our own state-based healthcare exchange, politics aside, if we're going to argue states' rights, and I believe the state should have taken the lead on this, then we should have taken that position. But yes, that's
three more short questions, and I'll let you go. So basically, the state didn't want to do this, but now that we see it coming, we're going to appoint the guy that's going to approve these folks to oversee it. And would you tell me, is it not true that if we look at the race for this elected official, how much of that pie which would take it to run a campaign comes from people associated with the insurance industry?
You know, that's a very interesting question and one that I don't have an answer for.
Last one. Senator, is there any way we could equate this to the old axiom that this is sort of like the fox watching the hen house?
I believe the senator has great passion for what he knows.
Chair recognizes Senator on 35th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the gentleman yield, please?
I will.
Isn't it true that our author of this legislation has stated that navigators will be paid by federal funds?
I believe that's correct.
Will the gentleman further yield?
I will.
And isn't it true that if they are using federal funds, that they should also use the federal regulations so that we can be in compliance to what the federal law says?
I believe the Senator from the 35th is correct.
And will you further yield?
I will.
Isn't it true that your amendment is only trying to bring us in line with the federal definition?
That is all my amendment does.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President.
No other questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes Senator from 39th. Speak to the bill.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, how I vote on this bill will be determined most likely by the fate of the amendment from the senator from the 22nd. But let me just say this, and conceptually, I have no problems with this idea of navigators because the healthcare exchanges are going to be very complex. The offerings to our constituents, the offerings are going to be very complex, just like with the pharmaceutical benefit. When that began under a Republican governor, a Republican president about 10 years ago, very complex, and you remember the difficulty your constituents had in navigating the pharmaceutical benefit. Very difficult, very complex. So this idea of counselors is probably a good thing. We use it kind of using nonprofit organizations for HUD housing counselors. It's kind of the same concept. Get the private sector, private nonprofit sector involved in giving advice to people who are dealing with bureaucracy. So it's probably a good idea. At the same time, I wish in those navigators, it's interesting what is being proposed this morning is that these navigators will be trained by the state insurance commissioner's office. The criteria will be set by the state insurance commissioner. And I'm sure those navigators will take into consideration local Georgia issues, concepts, and ideas.
probably a good thing. But why not have these navigators deal with state exchanges? The whole debate between state or federal exchange is this. The state exchange is more likely to do what? Be able to adapt to Georgia circumstances. But now, unfortunately, we're going to have somebody in Washington determining what an exchange in Georgia is going to look like. I mean, I appreciate and I support, and conceptually, as I said, the need for navigators, but why not have navigators navigate our constituents based on Georgia issues with a state exchange? That's what the only concern that I have. You know, if you want to use the navigators, fine. But why not do it with a state exchange as opposed to a Washington, D.C. exchange? I would think that my friends on the other side of the aisle would find that attractive and appealing. Let's have an exchange based on what? On Georgia circumstances. But no, the navigators are going to have to talk to our constituents about Washington, D.C. regs and rules. A state exchange would be able to put regs and rules in place that would be based on Georgia circumstances, closer to home, knowing Georgia better, local control. So I guess I'm, you know, espousing a concept that the other party is supposed to hold near and dear. Local exchanges for local circumstances. That's what I'm in support of. I wish the governor had seen fit to create not only a state health exchange, but also to do what? Expand Medicaid. 650,000 of our constituents would have been otherwise able to get health care, save 700 lives a year. The governor has not seen fit so far based on politics. That's okay. We understand. Well, it's not okay. It's bad for Georgia. It's bad for our constituents. As I said, I will vote on this based on what happens to the amendment from the senator from the 22nd. But I guess this is the first step toward Obamacare. You're going to have an opportunity to vote for the first step toward Obamacare. I appreciate the opportunity to do that with you. Thank you, and I yield the well unless there are questions.
No questions, Senator. Senator from the 8th, you wish to close? Nope. All right. The question now is on Amendment Number 1, authored by the senator from the 22nd. Is there objection? There is objection to Amendment Number 1, authored by the senator from the 22nd. All those in favor of Amendment Number 1, rise, stand, and be counted. Ayes and nays. All those in favor of Amendment Number 1 will vote aye. Those opposed, no. And Secretary will unlock the machine. Amendment Number 1. On the Amendment Number 1, the yeas are 16 and the nays are 36, and the amendment has lost. The question now is on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, the committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agree to report a committee which favor pass the bill. Chair is none. Report a committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair is none. The main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass the bill. All those in favor, Vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 37 and the nays are 15. And this bill, AMC Rex Constitution majority, is therefore adopted. Secretary will read House Bill 202.
House Bill 202 by Representative Epps of the 144th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Title 32 of the OCGA relating to highways, bridges, and ferries so as to provide for requirements for performing value engineering studies and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Transportation recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. The Transportation Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 202, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Title 32 of the OCGA relating to highways, bridges, and ferries so as to provide for requirements for performing value engineering studies and for other purposes. Through with the order, Mr. President.
Chair recognized, Senator on the 51st. Present the bill. Please give the Senator your attention.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. President. Today I bring to you House Bill 202, sponsored by Representative Epps, the 144th. This bill does a couple of things. I'll go through it real briefly and we'll yield for questions. First section is a section dealing with value engineering. It simply increases the dollar amount that is required by the DOT to conduct value engineering studies from $10 million to $50 million in a project. The second section of the bill simply excludes the interstate highway systems and freight corridors from congressional balancing. Mr. President, I'll yield the floor for questions.
There are no questions, Senator. Questions on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agree in the report of committee, which will pass the bill. Chair hears none. Report of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair hears none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question is on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. And secretary will unlock the machine. Thank you. on the passage of the bill. The yeas are 48 and the nays are 3. And this bill, AMC Rex Constitutional Majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes the distinguished majority leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the Senate stand adjourned until 10 a.m. Tuesday, March 12th.
10 a.m. March the 12th. Read the announcements.
Rules will meet upon adjournment in 450 cap. At 1 p.m., Insurance and Labor in 450 cap. At 1 p.m., Economic Development in 310 CLOB. 2 p.m., Judiciary, 307 CLOB. 2 p.m., Public Safety, MES 1. 3 p.m., Joint Science and Technology, 506 CLOB. 3 p.m., Regulated Industries and Utilities, 310 CLOB. 4 p.m., Health and Human Services in 450 cap. And the 4 p.m. Insurance and Labor Subcommittee meeting is canceled.
Chair recognized, Senator on 35th. What?
Please, Senators, thank you, Mr. President. The Mothers Against Drunk Driving are here today. This is Mothers Against Drunk Driving Day. It's not just mothers, it's everyone who cares about road safety. And there are pictures downstairs so you can see many of the victims who are victims of DUI, including my son. He's on that on there too. So please go down and say hello to them and get some literature that you can share with people in your community. Thank you very much.
Chair recognized, Senator on the 14th.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Science and Technology Committee will be joining in with the House Science and Technology Committee this afternoon at 3 o'clock for a presentation from MagnaGas, which is a new technology that's coming into Georgia. Uses consumable waste and turns it into manufacturing product. It's a really high-tech industry that I believe will bring a lot of jobs, and it's a clean energy source of industrial product. So we invite everyone who'd like to attend.
Majority leaders move. We stand adjourned until 10 a.m. tomorrow morning. All of those in favor will vote aye. or say aye. All those opposed, no? Ayes clearly have it. We stand adjourned.